Hi everybody, Christy Lesher here with Assisi Yoga. We are here for my part two class. They're not really sequential, but we were live last week on Tuesday night at 6, the first Tuesday of August. Second Tuesday of August is tonight. Third Tuesday of August is next week. So I'm thinking about them as a part one, part two, and part three. And so if you're just tuning in, welcome. And we're gonna focus tonight. Last week we looked at or explored poses that were on the sagittal plane, which is the plane of movement that moves us in forward and backward bends. So if you're interested and you missed that class, it's on the Assisi Yoga Facebook page, and you can find it just by scrolling down in the feed. If you're joining tonight, we're gonna be focusing on the next plane of movement that I'm interested in teaching on in this series, and that is the frontal plane. So this is the plane of movement that moves us side to side. So if you think about kids in school, and they used to read the Flat Stanley books, right? So it's like, imagine yourself as a paper doll and moving in the side to side plane. So that's what we'll be moving tonight. And just like last week, if you joined, or if you didn't, we're gonna be using similar props. So I'm just gonna back out toward my mat and show you what I've got out. So we have, I've got my mat, obviously. I have a block, and I have a second block just in case. It's always good to have two blocks, but one always is fine because rarely are we using both at the same time unless we're in lunge or something like that. So if you only have one block or one stack of books that you want to use, that's fine. I have two blankets, one extra and one that I'll be sitting on. And I have my trusty yoga strap, one of my favorite yoga props. So I'm just gonna check on the time. I'm gonna come to a seated position. So if you'd like to kind of get, if you are missing any props and you know you've got a block here or a strap there somewhere else in the house, feel free to go and grab it. And we're just going to start with seated breath, as I tend to always start my classes. So if you're just getting and gathering, no worries. Take your time. I like to start seated or lying down. That's always an option if for whatever reason you've been sitting a lot today, like I have been, for the other job, feel free to opt for lying down. It's always a great option for breath work as we come into the body and gain a sense of kind of where the breath is in the body. And we get the really good feedback from the floor. So if you do opt for laying down, I would recommend a folded blanket for a head pillow if you're flat on the ground, as in Shavasana. Or you can take a blanket and fold it this long, skinny way. This is a pranayama blanket fold, right? So you can take this thin blanket fold and lie on the mat with this supporting your spine. And this folded edge where the creases are supports your sacrum. And then this rolls up, this like lines up against your spine, and you get this good information from the floor right through the breath. The inhale, you feel right the press of the floor, and you get this good information. So for simplicity, and so I can stay more in frame than if I was laying down, I'm gonna be seated tonight. So I'm sitting on a block. You can have a couple blankets, a bolster. You can sit flat on, you know, straight on the floor, flat without any props. But one of the things that sitting up is really great, one of the aspects of this taking a little bit of a seat is really great, is that it allows us to kind of come into this place where we can sit the sitting bones on the right on the edge of our surface, and then we get this tip forward. And if you're like me and things are tight right through our hip flexors, then you can take the blanket and give the knees something to press into, right? Which is really a nice little added component. If you are more flexible in that area, right? You might, your knees might come right to the floor, which is great. Then you're all good. No need for a little extra prep. But it is nice to kind of have something for the knees to release into, right? So you feel that support and you can really focus on the breath. You're not thinking like, oh, you know, why is this so tight? Why is this knee in this position and this knee is in that position? And if sitting like this is not great for your ankles, right? Lying down, as I mentioned, is a great option. So we're gonna begin so we can get started into class. And so we're gonna start by taking an observation, right? Before we go anywhere and we ask the breath to do anything, we start with an observation. So I'm going to just begin by lightly closing my eyes. Palms can rest on the thighs. Or if you're laying down, right, the arms would come a little bit away from the body. We want to create space between the arms and the torso for the breath to move. And we start to stream the breath through the nose. Soften the jaw. Soften the back of the throat. So as the inhale comes in through the nostrils and down through the back of the throat and down into the lungs, the breath comes in and finds this soft entry point into the body. And so we want to see if we can release any restrictions up through the nostrils, down through the throat, and give this nice open passage for the breath into the body. And then we let the exhale just trail back out, right? We just reverse that path. And the exhale trails back out through the nose. And the first thing we're doing is just capturing this sense of our natural state of breath. It's giving us this transition point from all the tasks and to-dos that came before this moment in our day. And helps us to find ourselves just in this place. Creating some distance and space from what has come before. And then we're going to move to this place of focusing on the inhale today. I think last week, I'd have to go back and watch the recording, but I think last week we did elongated exhale. No matter whether we did this or not, or did the opposite, we're going to focus on this inhale today. We're going to be moving in this direction of frontal plane movement, right, side to side. So in order to find that movement, we're going to be thinking about the length on our side bodies. So over your next couple inhales, see if you can start to elongate that inhale, right? So it's not a big, deep, drastic, startling inhale. It's not quick. It's a long, slow, steady, drawn out experience. You want to see if you can let the exhale just ride where it is, right? It's just sort of the passenger. It's the passive passenger part of the breath. And tonight, the inhale, we're going to see if we can, on the inhale, right, we get this lift through the body. So we think for sure, length along the spine as we inhale. The exhale comes and we think about grounding through those sitting bones. And then from that place of grounding, the inhale rebounds and grow taller, grow a little bit taller in your seat. Sitting bones stay anchored. But use that extended inhale experience to lengthen the spine up and expand the side body out, right? We're starting to think length along the spine and expansion along the side body. So the breath moves us not only up and down, but expands us to the left and right. See if you can find that essence in this breath. A couple more breaths here on this slightly longer inhale. And then we'll let that go, right? As you come to your next exhale, just let that exhale go. And as your next inhale comes, just let it be your natural steady state, right? So no long, big expansion through the next exhale. Just kind of that, again, back to that passive state breath. And now if you had your eyes closed, you can start to crack the eyes and slowly open. If you opted to lay down for the breath, then I'd invite you to bend your knees one at a time. And then instead of sitting up off of the blanket, roll to one side. So roll off of the blanket to one side, and then you use that upper hand, press into the floor, and up you come back to sitting. And if you've been sitting, as I have, go ahead, use the hands to help bring the knees back in to midline. If you had any props supporting the knees, pull that to one side. Extend the legs out and away. If you're up on a seat, come off of that seat and just come to the floor and extend those legs. And now here's a quick little revisit from last week, which was sagittal plane. Inhale, those arms all the way up, nice and tall, and you feel right side body. So you have this nice breath, inhaling up, all the way up through the arms, extending from the side bodies up through the arms. And then we're going to exhale and just fold forward, right? And so the goal here isn't to get all the way to the floor. If you do, great, congratulations for being so flexible. But right, the goal here is just a little forward bend movement, right? We haven't done much. We haven't done anything to stretch the hamstrings, so we're not going far. We're just going to bend, forward bend that forward over the front legs, and back up we go. All right, I'm gonna clear the props off of my mat completely, so both blankets are gone to the side. Blocks off to the side. And we're gonna come to our mats on our backs, and we're gonna use our straps. So if you have a belt or something that's standing in for a belt, grab it. We're gonna go down for Supta Baddha Gustasana, which we practiced last week, but it was on the variation one, right? Where the leg just comes straight in, where we were just practicing, right? This forward bend at the hip. So tonight we're gonna practice, we'll go there for a moment just to find some length on the back leg, but then we'll take the leg out to the side and find, right, we're starting to move in this place where the limbs go out from the body, and we're finding this frontal line movement. So go ahead, take your strap if you have one and loop it to the ball of your foot, right? Notice I'm not on my arch. I'm up on the ball of my foot so I can press into the strap. I'm gonna lay back and I'm gonna extend my leg on the floor, right? So if you extend this lower leg, the leg that's on the floor, and it feels like just there's too much arch in the low back, then you just rewind this leg and you take this bent knee variation and just take some of the extension off the low back if it's too much, just given whatever is happening in your body at this moment. If it's okay, you press that leg out and away
And you really activate all the muscles down through this leg are active, and I'm pressing out through that foot on the floor as if I could press into the wall that's out there away from my mat. And then I use the breath here, right? Inhale, I think length along the back of my leg that's with the foot in the strap. It's my right leg. You might be on your right or your left. It's all good, whichever leg you started on. And I'm finding right a couple breaths here to let the hamstring extend and stretch out on the back leg. And one of the questions that I get a lot is about the size of this loop, right? If you're super flexible, then you may be here, right? You might not even need the belt. You would take the big toe. I'm not there because when I take the big toe, this shoulder comes off of the floor. So you want to be in the place where this arm is extended. This leg is ideally extended, but you might be practicing with a bit of a bent knee, just depending on how tight your hamstring is. But we're working toward a place where the knee can extend, the arm is extended, and then however big this loop needs to be so that your shoulder blade on that back arm can press into the mat. That's your measuring stick. And then, okay, we're going to spin this leg in its socket, and we're going to take this. I'm on my right leg, so I'm opening my right leg to the right side. And we keep pressing into the strap while we make this opening this leg to its own side. Keep the leg on the floor really active, glutes engage. And you can take this arm, which is not in the strap, and just extend it out away across the floor. You'll notice we're in this pose. If you were to stand on your foot that's in the strap, so if I were to stand up into this leg, someone could come and pick me up and put me on that foot. I would be in Ardha Chandrasana, half moon, which is where we're headed toward the end of this class. It's sort of the penultimate pose in this sequence. And so breathe through. You're getting stretch on the inner line of the leg, of the right leg, if it's your right leg that's looped. And you're engaging these glutes. So these glutes that are close to the floor, they're not doing nothing, right? There's still action through that hip. Good. Inhale this leg up. We come. We release the strap. We'll save the other variation of Supta Padangusthasana for next week, which moves us into a new plane of movement. But tonight we're just here. Ah, and then we compare, right? I like to see. How does the left and the right leg feel in comparison with each other? Right, a little longer. Maybe the leg that's been stretched feels a bit longer. So in the goal is, you know, we want to keep everything even. We'll loop the other foot. Again, take care to loop at the ball of the foot. Press up through that strap. See, my left side is a little tighter. So I'm going to give myself a little more room. I already know, right, from working in my own body and knowing my own body, left hamstring is a little tighter, so I give myself a little more room. Press out through the floor level leg. You check the low back. You say, ooh, that feels like a bit much. You can bend the knee. If it's okay, you keep it extended. That right leg, that right foot now for me, it's my right foot on the floor, my leg pressing out away. Really active. A lot of the work is in this floor level leg. And then left leg, which is looped, I press up through the ball of the foot. Feel that back of the left leg stretch. And then I check. Oh yeah, my shoulder blade is, I'm able to feel like I'm pressing that shoulder blade into the mat on the left. So I know I've taken a long enough loop in my belt. I'm gonna rotate this leg in its socket right before I open. I'm going to rotate, and then I'm going to go ahead and open my left leg to the left side. Keep this right side really active, glutes especially, right, engage and hold us to the floor on this side. This leg still completely firm and engaged while this left side gets to stretch. And I'm still pressing out into that strap, right? The ball of the foot still pressing. And I'm finding inner line of the left leg lengthening, and I can take this arm that's out of the strap and extend it along the floor, and I go, oh yeah, this feels familiar. If this foot was on the floor and my strap was a block, I would approximately be in Ardha Chandrasana, a couple refinements, which we'll find in the pose. Go ahead, inhale, this leg comes up, 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 up. Release the strap, lower, lower. And we, again, pause and check left and right leg. Right, see how they compare with one another. Nice and even. I'm gonna bend my knees and roll to one side, press into the floor. We're gonna come up away from the mat. And we're gonna start to build up right into some standing poses. We're gonna kinda come up in bits and pieces. We're gonna go next into spinal waves. And we're gonna go right into spinal wave variation two, which moves us on the frontal plane. So we'll be moving laterally, right, left and right. So I'm gonna show you this a couple different ways, and hopefully one of them is illuminating. This one is a bit tricky, right? Spinal wave one is where we do cat-cow, right? We do flexion, extension and flexion. Spinal wave two is where we move side to side. So we compress the side body. Like think of the spine like an accordion, right? And you're gonna bend the accordion, you know, tight on one side and open on the other. So that's kind of the shape of the spine. So go ahead, come to all four, knees, hips right over the knees, shoulders over the wrists or palms, maybe a little bit ahead, right? We like a little room for the spine to move here. So if these arms are on a little bit of an angle, it's all good. And then we're gonna bring a little bit of flexion to the spine, not full flexion, but some amount of flexion. And I'm going to take my left hip and my left armpit, and I'm going to squeeze them toward each other. So I'm going to face you for a second so you can see. I take a little flexion and then left and left, squeeze toward each other while the right side gets to expand, expand, expand. And hold that there, right? Really send the breath out into the side body. And then come back through center. And then we always check, before we do the next side, we check for that bit of extension, right? Or that bit of flexion. We want to have a little rounding in the back. And now I'm going to compress my right side. So my right side compresses. My hip and my armpit get close together. And this left side gets to expand and breathe out into this side body, right where those ribs are getting a little stretch. Come back through center. And this time when we go, we're going to do each side again. We're going to watch out for this one. Often when we go to one side, we swing the hips. So I'm going to go kind of on an angle, right? So what I see a lot is we go to one side and we swing the hips way out. See how my thighs go on an angle? So we want to keep the thighs on the vertical. So we're gonna go one more time, right? Flex, and then left side squeezes, right side expands. And I'm minimizing, right? I'm not pressing out through my hips. I'm keeping those thighs on the vertical. Come back through center. Get that little bit of flexion in the spine, and then right side compresses, left side expands. And we check, right? We check, have we pressed out through the hips or have we cut the hips right over the knees? That's where we want to be. Come back through center. And go ahead, come off of those wrists. Take a little break. Circle the wrists maybe. So, right, so if we use the hips, if we let the hips kind of go lead us through that spinal wave variation. We lose some of the good flexion and extension, the side-to-side flexion and extension that we could be experiencing, right? If we let the hips go,
we're not really isolating the stretch that we want side to side. So it's just a little something to keep an eye out for in that situation. All right, we're gonna come to our mat again. We're gonna press back into a child's pose. So go ahead, my toes are together, my knees are apart. I'm pressing back into child's pose. Forehead can release into the mat. Breathe here, right? So we were just moving side to side. So here we're just gonna let the spine spill forward out of the pelvis. And I'm gonna activate my hands into the mat, right? So we're about to press up into downward dog. So get those palms, fingers are well spread. So you see a lot of the mat between the fingers, and press into those palms, and then come away from the heels. Turn your toes to the mat and press yourself up and back into Adho Mukha Svanasana, downward facing dog. I know this is sagittal, this is forward. Forward bend, but one of the things I want to feel tonight is this, we talked about it for just a moment last week, but we're thinking about this line, right? This long line from the hip all the way through the side body up into the arms and then pressing in to the mat. So as you breathe through this downward dog, just a couple more breaths here, really feel that side body extension. And then go ahead, walk the hands and the feet together. And then go ahead, bend the knees. And then press into the feet to bring ourselves back up to standing. I'm gonna turn to face you. And so we're gonna take a Tadasana where we lift the arms, and we're gonna take that same pattern that we just had in spinal waves, right? This side to side motion through the torso. We're gonna find that same kind of motion through the torso in Tadasana. So ground through your feet, first of all, right? Really expand the feet out along the mat. And I have a bit of a, right, so I'm not standing right close together. I have a little bit of distance. I'm about hip distance through my feet. And then I'm going to inhale, the arms up. Ah, and here's the same sensation, right? Side body up into the arms as we inhale up. And now we're going to take everything and we're going to flex the spine to the side. Right, and we're going to be mindful of the same thing here, right? If we were not mindful, we would do this with the hips, right? The hips push this way, and then the spine has a lot of room to go this way. That's not what we're after, though. We're going to keep the hips right over the legs. And we're really just looking to isolate this move in the spine. I'm just going to turn, right? And breathe up through this side. Turn back. Inhale back up through center. And then we exhale to the opposite side. So I'm on my left side now. And I'm careful too, right? Watch. See how much far I can go? Oh, I can go so far into the pose this way, but that's not the pose. The pose is to keep the bottom half of the body quiet while we flex the underside and extend the opposite side of the spine. Breathe through. Up we come. One more time each side. Go ahead. Back to the first side, mindful of those hips, really feeling right, the nice long extension along that outer side, back up through center. One more time, second side, second time, we come
over, managing right now any sway through the hips. Back up we come, arms down, and pause. Right now we breathe here and we say, oh, is there more this? Do we have more of our up and down direction? Because we just found length on the side body. You might feel a little taller because we kind of scooched ourselves left and right, and found ourselves tic-tacking a little taller. All right, from here, we're gonna step wide. If you'd like, if you have blocks, now would be a good time to grab them and put them, just set them at the back. First pose is warrior two, so we won't use them in the first pose, but our next two poses will utilize them. So we're gonna step wide. Step as wide as your, if you extend your arms to the left and right, where your wrists are is about where your ankles should be. So it's a nice wide stance on your mat for standing poses. And then we're gonna turn toes out, back toes turn in, and we're going to bend that front knee. Head to Virabhadrasana 2, warrior two. So right, first things first, we're just gonna find the base of the pose. We're gonna find this knee bent over the rib, over the ankle rather, right? So if we go beyond, that's not good, right? We're putting undue pressure on the ankle than is needed. So it's the knee stacked over the ankle, back leg, right? We're pressing down into this back leg. This back leg is an anchor point down into the mat. We press with the back edge of the foot, and then we extend the arms to the left and right. Breathe through, right? Breathe to pose. Adjust and refine. Check the shoulders. Sometimes we hunch the shoulders up, so we want to descend those shoulders down the back body. And go ahead, press into that front foot. We're going to pivot through the feet, so we'll turn these toes out on our other side. Turn them out, and those back toes just make this little turn in, right? This back foot kind of turns in and points us in this direction. Go ahead, bend that front knee. Again, check, right? So sometimes I come down into warrior two and I think this leg could be a little lower. So I just go walk that back leg out, right? I'd rather take more distance to find the right position for this front leg, front thigh, than to just stay where I am and press further. Because pressing further takes the knee over the ankle, which is pose. Extend the arms to the left and right. Virabhadrasana 2. Don't forget the back leg, right? We're pressing down into the back leg, pressing down into the pinky side of that foot so we're not crashing or rolling through the arch. Press into that front foot. Extend the front knee. All 10 toes forward. Your choice, either step together or jump back together into Tadasana. Right, and pause a moment here. Couple breaths. And then again, your choice, step the feet out or right, take the reverse, little jump out. We're gonna go to extended side angle. So we start the same way. We turn the toes, front toes out. We turn those back toes in. We start by descending this front knee. So unlike warrior two, an extended side angle, right? In warrior two, we keep the torso upright. Here we get to go over that front leg, extend that upper arm. Right now you're this nice, do you remember this sensation? There it is again, but now it's just one-sided. Nice long line from that back pinky edge all the way up through the side body, out through the arm. And you can either use
the arm pressing into the thigh, or if you prefer, grab the block, bring it in behind you, right? You find the height of the block that works for your pose. Breathe through. Swing that arm back around. Press into this front foot. Pivot. Now your back toes are your front toes. And they point out directly. My foot is straight, pointing straight off the end of my mat. Those back toes have turned in. Again, starts the same way. I'm gonna descend, right, straight down toward my mat. Front leg bent, and then I get to give over the torso to this front side of the pose. And again, find this long line of extension. That back pinky edge presses into the mat. And then I've got this line all the way up through the outside of that back leg, up through this upper line of my torso. And there's that line from downward facing dog, from the Tadasana with the arms lifted. And again, if you prefer, you can use the block on the back. Swing that arm back around, press into that front foot. Step back together, step or jump. Right, stand into those feet. And pause one more moment, a couple breaths into Tadasana, right? We find kind of this centering moment after we've stepped wide and extended the limbs wide. We come back and find the midline. Feet press into the floor. Inhale lifts us up. All right, and now as I referenced at the beginning when we were in Supta Padangusthasana with the belt and we opened the leg to one side, we're headed toward Ardha Chandrasana. So the awesome thing about being home is that you, if we were in a studio, I would say, you can practice this pose in the middle of the floor, or you can go find a wall. And if I were going to teach it against a wall, it would be, since this is in frame, I'm going to use the end of my couch. So you may have a table or a chair or a side of a couch or a coffee table. You can use all of these things as props. Way more options than we would have in a studio. So if you're going to use a surface like the back of a couch or a really sturdy table to lean into, or a wall if you have one, You'll be in this vicinity. You'll come to your surface and you'll be close enough to it so that your back hip makes contact and will be right somewhere in this vicinity. And then you've got this little checkpoint for balance. So if you would prefer to rearrange or reorient yourself in your space to find a little prop for balance check, go for it. I'm going to teach right here on the mat and just talk you through this pose. So I'm going to have my block on the back edge of my mat. We're going to start, right, this pose starts the way other standing poses start. I'm way to the far end of my mat, however. Instead of kind of being in the middle, I'm all the way at the back end of my mat. Because I need to have room up there, right, as I go forward. My toes are pointing out directly, and this block is behind and in front of my toes, as you can make out on the video. And then to go into Ardha Chandrasana, this pose starts the way the other two did, right? I'm going to bend that front knee, find my block, lift off and extend that knee, and then you can bring in the upper hand. If this feels more safe, you keep that upper hand. And then you just spot a place on the floor to look at, steady your gaze, and find your balance. And if you have to break the pose, you lose your balance, you wobble, you come out, fine. Reset yourself
And you go again. Remember, balance is like any muscle that we build. The more we practice.
Right, and we care a bit less about where this leg is in space. It may be lower. It may be coming straight out of the hip. You may go down closer to the floor, so therefore the leg goes higher. Right, we're less interested in where this leg is in space, but how strongly does this back leg press away? Remember in Supta Padangusthasana, this is the floor level leg. This is the leg on the floor, active. And then to come out of Ardha Chandrasana, I bend the knee I'm standing on and just send that leg back and away, and up we come. We'll trade sides. So bring your block to the other side. If you were against a prop or a wall, you just go to the other side, just as you would on your mat. All right, toes face out. This back heel is all the way at the end of my mat. Then I'm gonna bend this knee, find the block. The nice thing about this entryway to Ardha Chandrasana is there's always a couple touch points on the floor, right? Both feet. Then I find the block. Oh, then I have the block, or my hand on the block and my foot on the floor. Then I lift the back leg. And I find a steady place here. Ah, frontal plane, all limbs extending strongly away from the midline. Right, if you were a paper doll, this is easy. And remember this back leg, right, this leg that's in the air. If we were in Supta Padangusthasana on the floor, this would be the leg pressing out along the floor, completely active. Toes face out into the middle of the room, right? Not down, not up, not pointed. Foot in flexion. And then bend that knee. Send the foot back along the mat. Ah, all 1, 2, 3 limbs on the floor. And then up and away we come. All 10 toes face forward. Step together. And pause into Dasana. So Ardha Chandrasana is this huge expanding. There's no more expanding pose in yoga, right? As all limbs go out and away, first from a standing pose perspective. There's a lot to keep track of. Limbs in multiple directions and the balance component. So we pause here into Dasana for a moment, right? And we gather all that energy back in to the midline. I'm gonna turn on my mat to face my mat the long way. Move my block. We're gonna go down the way we came up. I'm gonna inhale. Up into Tadasana. Ah, let those two side bodies, left and right, equally feel nice and long. And then fold all of that forward. Find the mat with the fingertips. Walk the hands forward. Step the feet back. Adho Mukha Svanasana, downward facing dog. And this is, I know downward dog is an active pose, but take this softer approach to it. Right? Try not to be so rigid in this downward dog. Just take the shape of the pose. And then go ahead, bend both knees down to the mat. Toes under, press back, downward dog, child's pose. Drag those hands in, press into the floor, and bring yourself back up, only to come over onto your back. Have a blanket handy, because after this, we're headed toward Shavasana. So just have that folded blanket ready. We're just going to come onto our backs. My knees are over my hips. I'm just going to use my hands on my knees to circle the back of the sacrum on the floor. So I'm just rolling through the backside of my waistband. So right, you've got this lovely bone called the sacrum at the bottom of your spine. It's the last simple vertebrae of your spine that acts as one piece. And so roll like ovals, right? Because nothing is a perfect circle or a straight line. There's no such thing as that in the body. So roll through, nice long ovals through this shape. Just trace this oval shape and then change direction with the knees and roll in the other direction. Go ahead, bring both feet down to the floor. And then if you've got your blanket handy, you can just slide it in. A little head pillow. Really good. At least, right? Minimalistically, I would say grab a head pillow, little something to lift the head and bring the chin a little in a little bit for Shavasana. And then it's your choice with the legs. You can extend the legs out in a way as they are. You could give yourself a little rolled blanket at the back of the knees, or if you've got a bolster, you could. So a little something under the knees is great. So make your choice, right? And settle back and down and into Shavasana. So we have just a couple more minutes of class. We'll use them to release all of the work and all of the effort of the yoga practice, right? The word yoga, the root yug, meaning union in Sanskrit, or to unite. And so through the practice of yoga, we're looking to bring the body and the breath and the mind, right? We're trying to bring all of these threads back together through the active practice of the poses. And then once we kind of get all of those threads pulled back together and recombined, we're in this really good place for the mind to just rest, and for the body to rest, and the breath just kind of hovers over both of those elements. So release all the muscles through the legs. Let the toes melt off to the left and right. Release the back of the pelvis down into the mat. I get the sensation that the left and right halves of the pelvis settle evenly down into the floor. Let the thoracic spine area, the shoulder blades kind of pool and settle into the floor. All the muscles along the arms release. Yield the back of the skull into your blanket or into your mat. Really feel the weight of your head give over into what's beneath you. Soften your face and your jaw, all of your features. And just settle back and into Shavasana. and come back from Shavasana. Just bring your next inhale a little more deeply into the body. Right, as the mind and the body rest in Shavasana, and the breath is the last active component, that's the thread that we grasp to come back to the mind and back to the body. And do it through the breath. Let that awareness spread from the breath out through the limbs, and when you're ready, you can draw one foot in and then your other foot in. Roll to one side and pause there in this most sacred pose, this original pose. And then when you're ready, you can press into the floor. Slowly bring yourself back up to sitting. And then bring the palms together. In gratitude. Namaste. Thank you for joining, and I will look forward to our third in this Tuesday night series next week. I'll be off for a little while, a little short break. We'll look at what things look like in the fall and be back. So thanks again for joining, and may you have a lovely night, or if you're watching this sometime in the future, may whatever comes next be lovely. Thank you.